For our final presentation, please welcome Golf Canada's new Chief Sport Officer, Kevin Blue, who's going to share an overview of activities across grassroots, golf services, and high-performance sport. Kevin, over to you.
Thank you, Lindsay, and bonjour tout le monde. My name is Kevin Blue, as Lindsay said, and I started in the role of Chief Sport Officer here at Golf Canada in January. So it's only been a few months, but I've been fortunate to meet many people from around Canada so far, virtually, of course. So thank you for your warm welcome, and I look forward to meeting many more of you as we move forward. Well, while I'm still new to Golf Canada as an employee, and in fact, I'm actually even still living for the time being in California, where my old job was located. Some of you might know that I have lots of previous experience with golf in Canada. And I wanted to show you a picture that Dan Pino and Derek Ingram both sent to me when I first joined Canada a few months ago. This is a picture of the 2001 Canadian team at the World Junior Boys Championship in Japan. And you can see in the back there, there's a fresh-faced Derek Ingram supervising a group of young guys who are, it turns out, all wearing ill-fitting red blazers, but thrilled to be over in Japan representing Canada. You can see me on the front right as I try my best to fit in with some tremendous players. On the left is JC Deacon, who's now the head coach at the University of Florida. Next to JC is Richard Scott, who won the Canadian Amateur 3 times. And of course, next to me, to my right, is James Lepp, who many of you will remember won on the Canadian Tour while he was still an amateur and would go on to win the NCAA Individual Championship in 2005. Of course, for me, this was a very memorable moment in a broader golfing journey. I grew up in Toronto, where I started to play the game at Don Valley, the Don Valley Golf Course, using the municipal pass that juniors could buy at a reasonable price. And my hockey teammates and I went out and we had a great time learning the game and playing together. I also formed extraordinary relationships with people who are still friends to this day. While I worked at the Donalda Club in the back shop under the mentorship of head pro Ken Tarling. My friends and I parked carts together. We scrubbed clubs together, either from 6 a.m. until 2 p.m. or 2 p.m. until close. And we learned about life and golf together. I was also fortunate to be part of the sponsored junior program at Bayview Country Club, thanks to the opportunities provided by their members and head professional, Warren Crosby. I remember getting together with other juniors one day in the summer and playing 54 holes. We started early, finished the first round mid-morning, finished the second round mid-afternoon, finished the third round at about 6 p.m. And we actually said to each other, hey, maybe we can sneak in another round before sunset if we play fast and get in a full 72. But we didn't end up going for it. We were a little bit too tired at the time. But my parents were very supportive of my interest in golf, but they were not club golfers themselves. I was still able to participate and grow in golf because of the affordable and accessible opportunities that were provided to me then. These opportunities ended up being life-changing for me. Golf took me to Stanford for school and provided extraordinarily fortunate life experiences and relationships that profoundly shaped my path. You know, like it has for so many of you, golf taught me about success and triumph and also about disappointment and heartbreak. And my golfing journey has taken me around the world. But most of all, golf really helped me understand the importance of having passion and dreams in our lives. And as a father, I think about this often. I think about the topic of passion and dreams often as we raise our kids. It's one of my hopes that our kids are blessed to be captivated by something to the same extent that golf captivated me. And not to mention, as a parent, it's also much easier to get the kids to put down their phones or turn off video games when they'd actually prefer to be doing something else anyway. In any case, the main purpose of this elongated introduction is really to emphasize to you that being here in this role with Golf Canada is very special to me. And, you know, all of us bring a set of experiences to our jobs, and my golfing journey will certainly influence how I contribute to our organization going forward. I wanted to share a few updates with you today about our work on the sports side of the organization. The first update is about First Tee. As has been discussed at length today so far, diversifying our sport and providing more accessibility to golfers from all backgrounds are important priorities in our game today. And implementing First Tee in Canada will help with these priorities. As Lawrence alluded to earlier, First Tee is an internationally successful youth development program that uses golf as a vehicle to teach life lessons. It's comprised of 150 chapters in 7 countries, and the curriculum of First Tee has been developed and refined over many years. It's delivered by instructors who are trained and certified through a robust and elaborate coach education program. First Tee has made an extraordinary impact on its youth participants in several different ways. It's created new relationships for them. It's made participants better students, and it's created a sustained connection with the sport of golf for life. In fact, 90% of First Tee alumni in the United States consider themselves to be golfers for life. And importantly, First Tee has also been successful at increasing the number of junior golfers who come from racialized backgrounds and other backgrounds that have traditionally been underrepresented in the sport of golf. As we implement First Tee Canada, ensuring that First Tee program locations are especially accessible and inclusive will be a specific goal of ours. I want to take a minute now to provide some additional detail about First Tee, about how First Tee is going to be structured in Canada. Golf Canada and the Golf Canada Foundation will be providing centralized administrative support for both operations and fundraising. Each province or region of Canada will then have a chapter that's affiliated with the provincial association in order to coordinate programming and generate revenue to support local program operations. Chapter staff in each province will be paid centrally by Golf Canada. The actual program is delivered at schools, community centers, and golf facilities by trained coaches and volunteers. We're working very closely with First Tee headquarters in the US and our fantastic partners at the PGA of Canada to ensure that coach training and coaching in First Tee will be of the highest quality. A great way to think about First Tee is that it will be an entry point into the sport for many golfers. Some First Tee participants will go on to play competitive golf and will enter the high performance pathway. Other First Tee participants will continue their relationship with golf at the recreational level for the rest of their lives. One thing is certain though, all participants will learn life skills and other lessons that will help them in their journey for years to come. Our intent is to launch, as Lawrence mentioned earlier, launch First Tee in British Columbia and Quebec in 2021 and in other provinces in 2022. The long-term impact of First Tee in Canada is really threefold. First, the program is going to have a significantly positive impact on Canadian youth. Second, the program will help to create more diversity and increase accessibility of golf in Canada. As I mentioned earlier, we tend to be very intentional about where we're locating programs and how we proactively reach out to traditionally underserved communities. And third, by virtue of this inclusive approach, First Tee will broaden the pool of talent for future elite Canadian players. It's important to note that First Tee will be driven primarily by philanthropic support. So we're very appreciative of the support that and involvement that many of you will have, and we look forward to a successful launch in 2021. My next update is about amateur championships. Conducting amateur championships is a core part of our business at Golf Canada, and national championships are very important to competitive players all across our country. It is indeed our goal to conduct national championships this year, and we're cautiously optimistic about being able to do so. However, we will remain in full compliance with all applicable public health guidelines, and we will continue to prioritize the health and safety of everybody involved, including players, volunteers, and host communities. Should it be necessary, in order to help our championships move forward, we will make accommodations to field composition and play domestic-only events, or even modify field sizes. Our intent is absolutely to award trophies this year and to do so safely. Cette année, nous sommes ravis de jouer des tournois au Québec. The women's amateur will be contested at Royal Montreal, always a fantastic test of golf. and the men's amateur will be played at Le Club Laval-sur-le-Lac. We hope to see many of you this summer in La Belle Province to the extent that public health guidelines permit. As Lawrence mentioned earlier, we're also very excited about the introduction of a new championship in 2021, a Canadian All Abilities Championship. More details will be communicated in the next few weeks as the hosting agreement with the host facility is finalized, but we're very excited about the potential for this new championship to strengthen our support across the country for golfers with disabilities. We're hopeful to see you at some point this summer as we crown some national champions. Speaking of champions, I also wanted to talk a little bit more about our work in high-performance golf and in player development. I've followed Canadian golf from the U.S. for the past 20 years. I've watched with pride as our players have grown in global prominence. The progress that we've made in recent years in high-performance golf and player development has been fantastic. And as we look forward, we're going to challenge ourselves to get even better. This year, we're embarking on a process to understand a few key questions that will help us unlock additional growth opportunities in high-performance player development. For example, what sustained level of achievement should we aspire to for Canadian golf on the global stage? In other words, how good do we really think we can get? We're currently engaged in an analysis of golfing countries, comparing nations across a number of different dimensions, such as population, climate, the number of golfers and number of golf courses, the cultural relevance of golf, GDP per capita, income distribution, the size of each national landmass, and many other factors, in order to more scientifically understand which countries in the world look most like Canada from a golf standpoint, and to understand what these countries are doing to develop their players. We've recently had discussions with player development leaders from Australia, Sweden, Denmark, England, and have many other conversations forthcoming. We've also met with representatives from Tennis Canada to understand the DNA of their recent success. Understand that our goal is not to copy others, but rather to fully understand what they do, how well it's working for them, and then to figure out what that means for Canada, given our unique circumstances. Zeeshan, I don't know if the slides are still up. I can't see on my end, but could you just pull them down so I can talk directly to the audience? Another question that we're thinking about is, how can Canada grow its talents pool? More specifically, how can we leverage the multicultural strength of Canada to develop players from a deeper and more inclusive group? As the demographics of Canada continue to diversify, so too must the racial and ethnic backgrounds of our elite players if we aspire to maximize the athletic talent devoted to golf in our country. Additionally, as was mentioned in the previous presentation, the demographics of leaders in our sport, including our high-performance coaches and coaches from around the country, should continue to evolve so that they're more increasingly representative of a broader talent pool of players. The ongoing Women in Coaching program that is a collaboration between Golf Canada and PGA of Canada is an example of a concrete step in this direction. The bottom line is that our high-performance system must be built to make sure that it is capitalizing on Canada's diverse strengths and embracing Canadian cultural diversity. For example, how do we make sure that our system takes into consideration the differences between English Canada, French Canada, and Canadians from various global backgrounds? Multiculturalism is indeed a differentiator of Canadian society, and intercultural competence in building our player development system will help us tap into one of Canada's biggest advantages and unlock an even broader talent pool. Lastly, on the topic of high performance, we're thinking more deeply about the role of sports science, analytics, and research. Of course, the emotional fuel for high-level golf will always come from our passion and desire to win. But our decision-making about how we build our systems should be guided by research and science to the maximum extent possible. And for that, we're working with our partners in the academic community to make an impact on our player development system. For example, we're embarking on a study to understand the age at which players who grew up in northern climates typically break through to the top 200 in the world. We're seeking to compare the developmental pace of Northern players against their warmer weather peers. If we find that Northern players who made it to the top 200 in the world actually ended up taking longer to do so, there are implications for how we structure our system going forward. For example, we want to make sure that our system is built to ensure patience, to account for late bloomers, and not to select out players too early. So we're digging into many of these items over the course of the year, and we really look forward to engaging with many of you on them. Please do reach out if you'd like to contribute and be involved. To close, I wanted to offer a few comments to thank Golf Canada member clubs and Golf Canada individual members for your involvement and your support. Your membership with Golf Canada supports our great game, which is a passion point for so many people across our country. We take very seriously our responsibility to grow and protect our sport, and because we know what our sport can do for us, our communities, and our country. Without your membership, none of the great things in our game that I've talked about over the last few minutes would be possible. So to conclude, thank you to member clubs, member facilities, and individual Golf Canada members. We're going to continue working hard to make you proud to be a part of our organization and to be a driving force of golf in Canada. And thank you for your time today.